Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a big hand clap. Oh, come on, that was you. Come on, give Jesus a big hand clap. Amen. It's good to see everybody alive this morning. Amen. Get your Bibles if you have your Bible with you. And we're going to get right into it this morning. Go with me to chapter 51. We'll give you some feedback up here, Johnny. Psalms 51. And put a marker there. And then go with me to Psalms 34. Just make a left. Your other left. And go to Psalms 34. 18. Put a marker there. And now make a right. Go to Psalms 147. And we're going to down to verse 3. And we're going to read these three scriptures this morning. I really feel that God's going to take us in a direction that is going to just open up new things within us. And I'm going to be talking about keeping the fire. Right before we do, yesterday, I just want to thank everybody for coming out. We had our evangelism outreach yesterday. It was powerful. We probably had about 30 people that came out. And it wasn't the men's home and the women's home. Can I hear your name? It was the church. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. And so, come on, give yourself a hand clap. We had a great turnout. We had a great teaching in the back. And not only that, but we went to Ayala Park. And we handed out hot dogs, and we just had a great time, man. I believe we were able to pray for people, and people, you know, we're letting them know we're here, amen?
Amen.
And we gave out almost like 160 hot dogs. I'm not sure if the 30 people that came with us ate them all or whatever. All I know, the 160 hot dogs were gone. Can I hear amen, somebody? I wanted to search Mondo when he left, because he looked a little bit bigger. I think he was strapped with hot dogs. He left in a hurry, amen? But seriously, we had a great time, man. A lot of people came out, and we were able to feed a lot of people and just minister. And Brother Brian, he ran the barbecue grill cooking hot dogs with a plastic fork. So, I mean, he had two of them. And you know how a fork has usually four little sticks in it? By the time it was done, it was only two left. So he did a great job, man. And I don't know how he did it. I didn't ask. I just would, you know, just cook him, brother. And so we had a great time. It was not only a great time of reaching out, but also reaching in because we had good fellowship and everything like that. We had a great time, man. So I want to thank everybody for coming out. As a matter of fact, we're going to be doing it on a monthly basis. I think the next one we're going to be going out is on October the 1st on a Saturday. So make it a point to be in one. Can I hear amen, somebody? Believe me, you'll be blessed, man. It's really a great, great opportunity to really express what God is doing in your life and to do something of service to God. It's always good to do things for others rather than yourself. You got to get out of self. Turn to your neighbor and say, we got to get out of self. And turn to the other side and say, yeah, you too. You better get out of self. We have too much self. But anyway, Psalms 51, and this message I'm going to be ministering this morning, it was something, I had another sermon that I had prepared to minister on this morning. This is how God works, and this is how God is so good, and he loves his people. But this morning, through a song, God ministered to my heart. On this topic that I'm going to be talking about. It came fresh this morning. And then I was able to discuss it with the men in the back of the office. And they helped me. We put some things together. And I really feel it's going to bless you this morning. Psalms 51, verse 17. When you have it, say, I have it.
I have it.
And we're going to the book of Psalms because David understood the topic I'm going to be talking about. He said, my sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, you, God, will not despise. My sacrifice, let me read one more time. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, God, you will not despise. Meaning you will not turn away from it. Now go with me to Psalms 34. It's good to hear all them pages. I like when my pastor used to always sing a song like Angel's Wings.
Come on.
Psalms 34, verse 18. When you have it, say, I have it.
I have it.
See, we're staying in one book that because I know who I'm talking to this morning. You'll get it later. Psalms 34, 18. The Bible says that the Lord, who is it? The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Now let's go to Psalms 147. And we're going to be reading verse 3. And this will be our last text for the main text. Psalms 147, verse 3. The Bible says, He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning in Jesus' name, God. I pray, Lord, that this morning that you would minister to every heart, to every life that is here today. I pray, God, that you would move in such a way that you would bring strength and encouragement. I pray, God, that you would edify every man, woman, and child in this building today. Father, I pray that you would be glorified in this house. Give me the words to speak, God. This is the word that you have placed in my heart for the people that are here this morning. I pray that every heart would be open, every ear would be open, God, and we would be able to hear what you are saying today. Father, I pray that we would not leave this place the same way, but that you would minister to every heart in this house. I pray, God, that you would be glorified by God and that you would have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. This morning I want to talk about on the topic we've been talking about for about a month and a half now, about keeping the fire for God. Stay on fire for God. You know, being keepers of the flame, keepers of the torch that God has lit within our life. And when you begin to bring that into, you know, words that are more understanding, it simply means this: keeping the passion for God. Being passionate for the things of God. Being passionate for what God has for your life. Being passionate for the salvation that God has given all of us. Not only that, but the Spirit of God that God has laid within our heart. Being passionate for the new life that we have and the destiny that is before us. Because we all have a God-given destiny that lays before us. And it's up to us whether we're going to receive it or not. Are we going to walk in it or not? So being passionate for God and keeping the fire. And we've been talking about a lot of topics about keeping the fire and different things that we need to do. But this morning, I just want to bring out a couple of things that I really feel that is beneficial to every person in this room here this morning. And in order for us to keep the fire of God burning within our heart, being passionate of God, there needs to be a sense of brokenness in every heart. That we need to understand that it's okay to be broken. See, if you read the scriptures, you find that God creates out of nothing. God doesn't need anything to create anything. The Bible says that the earth was void and null. There was nothing alive on the earth. It had no form, but that God spoke. And it was formed. He spoke everything into existence. So God creates out of nothing. And therefore, until a man is nothing, God cannot make nothing out of him. Now, I'm talking about this morning, talking about being broken in the presence of God. Being broken, carrying a brokenness within your spirit. I believe that God can do a greater work within our life when there's brokenness that we carry within our heart. And the way that I can prove my point this morning, that just consider your life when you came to Jesus. When you came to that place where, man, you finally gave up and gave in. And you said, man, you were at your lowest point in life. And brokenness was in you. And you came to the Lord Jesus with all your brokenness and all your broken parts and pieces. Can I hear an amen, somebody? I mean, you exhausted every avenue. You exhausted every resource that you had. Man, you got burned people. Man, we did all kinds of stuff, and there was nothing but brokenness left within our life. And it was at that very moment, at that point, where God, through Jesus Christ, His Son, called us out of our brokenness, and He lifted us up. Can I hear an amen, somebody? So it was through brokenness that all of us came to know God. I don't think that there's anybody in here that your life was all good. Everything was going great. You had everything that you need. All your emotions were in line. And you were Mr. and Mrs. Feel Good. Can I hear an amen, somebody? I mean, you had everything going for your life. And you said, I think we should give our life to the Lord now because everything is going great. Man, what else can we ask for? Let's just go ahead and go to church now. If you're here this morning, I want you to raise your hand. Oh, there's a lot of you guys. You came to church when everything was going good?
Oh, no.
See, you're all messed up. Man. You don't even know what I'm saying. The devil's good. We're all messed up.
Come on.
I was getting ready to put all you guys in the home, man. You guys are in the home. You might have had everything together, but you're a big liar. When we all came to the Lord, we had nothing but brokenness. And it was the brokenness that we had that led us to the foot of the cross. It was the brokenness that we had that brought us into a place of surrenderance. It was the brokenness that we had within our life that brought us into a place of willingness.
Amen.
When we surrendered unto Jesus Christ, that we had nothing else but our brokenness, and yet that's all we had, but that's all He wanted. Can I hear an amen, somebody? And that's all He wanted, and He accepted all our brokenness. Because God creates out of nothing. And it was the process that began in brokenness. Because number one, the brokenness is needed in order to begin transformation within your life. There needs to be brokenness before God is able to transform us. And when you come to the Lord, you bring your brokenness and you place it in the hands of God. You place it in the hands of God. When you begin to place all your brokenness in the hands of God, then that's when God creates something out of nothing. It's very careful that we need to understand that there's another hand that we can place our brokenness into. Some of us, we begin by placing our brokenness in the hand of God, but then we begin to listen to the enemy and listen to the criticism of the enemy and how he criticized the church, how he criticized people, and you end up taking out your brokenness out of the hand of God, and you put your brokenness in the hand of the devil. And he'll love to receive your brokenness. And in your brokenness, how do you know whose hand your brokenness is in? When your brokenness is in God's hands, God begins to build you up. God begins to strengthen you. God begins to speak life into you. You begin to be encouraged. You begin to be strengthened. You know, you get away from things that made you into that condition. And the transformation begins. But when you put your brokenness in the hand of the enemy, this is what the enemy says. Because in the brokenness, when you put it in the hand of the enemy, he uses pity, self-pity. And he'll tell you, nobody loves you. Nobody cares for you. Look at you're all messed up. Nobody cares about you. Nobody's concerned about you. God don't even love you no more. You blew it too much. This is how many 30th chance or 35th chance, and you're only 20 years old? Oh, hello, somebody. If the shoe fits, take it off. It's a hospital shoe. How many seen those hospital shoes? But when we put our hands, our brokenness in the hands of the enemy will use it to discourage you. You'll be surprised how many people are in the church that are broken in the presence of God. They have a brokenness, but it's not in the right hands. And the brokenness that they have, they put it in the enemy. And they're in the church. You'll be surprised how many people in the church that are still discouraged, that are still depressed, that are still walking around with all kinds of complexes, thinking because nobody likes them and the pastor don't like them and, you know, all this stuff. And they're always hurt, and they're there, and they're so focused on what's going on around what everybody else is doing. See, that's the difference, that when you put your brokenness in the hand of the enemy gets you to focus on everything around you. On the church, on the people, on everything. You begin to, you know, judge, and there you're in your brokenness, you can't even really see straight, so you're very easily to, you know, to be deceived. And the enemy will have you. And then there's no transformation, there's no healing, there's no, you know, building up, but everything being torn down even more. In your ashes. But when you give your brokenness into the hands of God, you know what happens? Is you don't look around, you look within. Amen. You look in yourself. And your eyes are in here. Your eyes are on yourself. Your eyes are what God is doing in your life. And how God is trying to mend the brokenness in your heart. How God is ministering to your life. How God is trying to build you up. And even yourself, without even the devil involved, are doing a good job in trying to still tear it down. Amen. Brokenness. Brokenness is needed to be transformed, but your brokenness has to be in the hands of God. There's a lot of examples of that. You find the Apostle Paul. When he was there, before he was Paul, he was Saul. Saul of Tarsus. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. This brother had been to the greatest schools there, where he in Jerusalem, wherever he went. He had the greatest teachers. I mean, he was, you know, he had it going on. Can I hear an amen, somebody? You know, he had rims on his chariot. He had glass packs on it. On the horses. He had the latest of latest, and this man, he was very arrogant and very proud. And he stood for God, and he represented the church. When Jesus came around, and Jesus began to walk the earth, and the church of Jesus Christ was formed, even Paul of Tarsus, he began to persecute the church. He was even there when the first Christian martyr, Stephen, was killed. Paul gave the approval of it, or at that time, Saul. He was very arrogant, and because of his arrogance and pride, he was very blinded, and his heart was far from God. God had to break him. He needed to be broken. And sure enough, his day came when he was going on the road to Damascus. There, him traveling with his companions, a bright light from heaven shined on him, blinded him, knocked him off his horse. This man who had control of his life, this man that was very arrogant, and you're self-sufficient, he didn't need nobody. All of a sudden, he found himself on the floor, crawling around, feeling around, totally helpless. Needed to be helped up and needing to be led when before he was the leader. All of a sudden, his life was changed. He never experienced brokenness within his life until he had an encounter with Jesus Christ. Next thing you know, he was led to a street called Straight, where the Lord told him to go and go to a man named Ananias from the very people that he used to persecute and even try to kill. He had to rely on the church, the one that he was trying to destroy, to pray for him. So they led him to that house, and Ananias laid hands on him, and from his eyes were like scales that fell. But he was broken in spirit, and he fasted and he prayed. And then from there, he went to the backside of Arabia for 3 years, where the Holy Ghost got a hold of his heart. And God began to transform his life. And then his ministry was birthed. And the next thing you know, you find the Apostle Paul. He's there traveling with the disciples, going out, and he was over the church of the Gentiles, the believers in Christ Jesus. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul wrote over 2/3 of the New Testament. But it was through the brokenness that he experienced and the brokenness that he put in the hands of God that he trusted in God. He knew at one point of his life, he said, everything that I've learned, everything that I've ever done, everything that I've ever accomplished, I call it rubbish, man. It means nothing anymore to accomplish the will and the purpose of God for my life, which was everything. Paul was a man that understood brokenness, that it became a transformation. Because brokenness is needed in order to be transformed. Brokenness is needed in order to be used. Brokenness is needed in order to be blessed.
Amen.
You want your life transformed. You want to be used by God. You want to be blessed by God. Brokenness needs to be in your spirit. It's brokenness. Look at Moses. Brother Mo. You know the story of Moses. He was an Hebrew slave. But his mother got him and hid him and put him down the river. And he went into the banks of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh's sister got him and raised him. He was raised in the palace. He was very well educated. He was an architect and helping build the greatest pyramids over there in Egypt. Very wise man. Brought up in the great, the newest of everything. Had everything, raised with a silver spoon in his mouth. Until he found out who he was, and God began to reveal who God was to him. The next thing you know, he was fleeing for his life. And for 40 years in the desert, for 40 years tending sheep, for 40 years, smelling like sheep, and sheep could smell. How many of you went to the fair and you smell some sheep?
Amen.
I mean, you go in there for 5 minutes, let's get out of here, man. These brothers stink. Well, the Bible describes us as sheep. And sometimes we stink. But Moses, for 40 years around that, this man of prestige, this man that had it all together, that was next in line to be king over Egypt. It was like the superpower of the world. It's like the United States. He was in line to rule and to reign, and he was taught the best. The next thing you know, you find him in the backside of the desert tending sheep. And by the time God called him, and by the time he had his encounter with God in the burning bush, that brother could barely talk. Because the Bible describes him as a man that had stuttered. This man that was well educated. He was broken. He went through a season of his life, which was for 40 years of brokenness. And the brokenness prepared him to be used by God. It's the brokenness that he was there. He couldn't even say anything. Can you imagine stuttering? And God told him to go to Pharaoh and tell him to let his people go. And he prayed and said, God. You know, like some of you used to talk when you were like that crack. What are you saying? His face did that, man. And after you come off a good one, you can barely talk. But Moses, man, for 40 years, he was so broken in spirit. He was so broken in who he was, man. By the time God prepared him, it took 40 years. Can you imagine 40 years in the home? In the men's home? The women's home? Some of you need to be there 40 years. Because you're not broken yet. You're still full of self. Moses, 40 years. By the time he was ready, he had total dependency on God. He relied totally on God for everything in his life. He moved when God told him to move. He did everything that God told him to do. Moses. How about Joseph? Joseph, man, he went through 17 years. After he had that dream, the next 17 years after that, his brokenness began. Being falsely accused. Being hated by his brothers. Being thrown in the pit. Being slaved into, being sold into slavery to the Midianites. Being accused of trying to get with somebody's wife. He was in the pit, the prison. But through his brokenness of 17 years after he ended up in the palace, God had to take him through the process of brokenness. Because brokenness is needed in order to be transformed. Brokenness is needed in order to be used. And brokenness is needed in order to be blessed. Some of us here this morning, you're in a place of brokenness. You're here, you're broken in spirit. Like the psalmist David wrote, he was broken in spirit and a broken, contrite heart. He was broken within spirit. He was there, meaning that he didn't depend on himself. There was nothing he could do for himself. And the Bible says that God will not despise a person that is broken in spirit and in heart. As a matter of fact, I believe why that's why, because even in another scripture says God is drawn to the brokenhearted. Why is God drawn to the brokenhearted? Because now you're pliable, God can begin to move in your life. It's when you weren't broken in the spirit and broken in heart, God couldn't do nothing in you. Because you're hard, you're callous, you're there, you're set in your ways, and you think you know everything. You try to tell yourself, I know. Man, you know everything. You know everything. They don't need Google, they need to call you. I don't want to Google, what do they call? Because you know everything. I mean, you know everything. And because you know everything, you're full of yourself. There's no brokenness within your spirit. I don't know about you, but the years that I've been serving the Lord, and not only pastoring, but as a child of God, as a Christian, serving the Lord, my best seasons in my life were lived when I was broken, when there was brokenness within my life. My worst seasons that I've had in Christianity, when I've allowed my heart to get hard, when I've allowed my heart to get callous and thinking that I had got it all together, thinking I could do this and that, thinking that, you know, you're getting weird in my thinking. And because of that, then God leads me to another place of brokenness. And said, Manuel, you're better off when you're broken, because when you're broken, you hear me. When you're broken, I'm able to work in you and work through you. But when you get full of self, Manuel, you are too much. Don't laugh at me, you're worse. Then we're not broken. So now, man, I love to be broken in the presence of God. I love brokenness within my spirit. Don't get me wrong, I don't walk around like I'm so broken and so weak. And no, when you're broken in the presence of God, guess what? God strengthens you, and then you get out of the presence of God, then you have strength. Yeah. All right. Then nobody's able to see the brokenness, only God. But see, some of us don't even go to God in our brokenness, so there's no strength. So your brokenness is revealed to everybody else. Meaning that you just go around calling everybody Tia Cuca and everybody Concha. And I hope nobody Cuca and Concha is here this morning. And you end up telling everybody about your broken problems. And you sound like a broken record. Over and over. That's why nobody answers the phone anymore. That's why people are not your friend anymore on Facebook and Instagram. Because all you're going to start a cryogram. We're going to start a cryogram. Put your cries here. But when you have your brokenness, and I believe that everybody in this room, there's a brokenness, a sense of brokenness within your life right now, in the season that you're in. I believe that God didn't give me this message just to say it. Like I said, I had something else to preach. And I was going to preach on something else. But God showed me this morning when I was in my prayer. I was getting to my prayer. Let me explain to you, then I'm going to close right now. Is how this happened. That's how come I know it's God. Because in the morning I go into a place where I pray, and I take my iPad and I put on worship music. And I go onto YouTube and I get on worship. There's certain worship leaders that I like to listen to. Besides Living Word Worship, hello somebody. This is my number one worship right here. We gotta get a CD, huh? Yeah. But when I'm at home, I get my iPad and I put on some worship. And so I went to my worship music lineup that I have there, and I put the first one. And it would come on for 1 second and go off for 5 seconds. Come on, you know how it's buffeting, whatever it's doing. It wouldn't play. So I went to the next one. It wouldn't play. I went to the next one. It wouldn't play. So I said, what's going on? Did we pay the bill? Hello, somebody. I saw little bars that said I have full bars of Wi-Fi. So I put on the next one, didn't play. So I'm looking down, I'm going up, down, I'm scrolling on this thing, and there's one song that came out on me. It said Brokenness. And I went to swung down, I didn't even want to look, and my finger hit it, and it went on. And it was Matt Gilman on Brokenness. And then it just started playing. It was 19 minutes of worship in that prayer on Brokenness. And I was there, and I was like, wow. And then I started getting into it, man, and it touched my, I go, oh, Lord. And man, I got broken in the presence of God. I was listening to it, man. I was crying like a big baby. Yes. And then I felt in my heart, that's what I want you to preach in the church. And so the song was over, and I still wanted to get some more prayer in. So I thought, you know how we get logical? Okay, now it's working now. So I tried to go back to the other song, it wouldn't work. Another one, it didn't work. Another one, it didn't work. The only one that worked was that one in Brokenness. I said, okay, Lord, I got the message. I got the memo. And so from that, I just came. I said, okay, God, give me something. He gave me those three things. And I'm just delivering what God told me to tell you this morning. There's a lot of people that are here this morning that thinks it's going to happen another way. But it's not. It's through your brokenness. Don't think wrong because of your brokenness. You're in a good place. God is getting ready to transform your life. God is getting ready to bring beauty out of ashes. My Bible says that weeping may endure for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. God is getting ready to do His great best work in your life, in your brokenness. In the place of need, there where you think nobody hears you, you think nobody is concerned about you. Oh, but God is so ever drawn to you right now. You're in a place where God is so drawn to you. He's closer than you think, man. He's right there in that situation with you. God is closer to you than you think. But He's coming at a way that you will never imagine. God is closer to you. God is getting you into a position where He's going to begin to transform you into a greater image of Himself. And He's preparing to use you. But if you're not broken, if you don't have that brokenness within your spirit, He can't use you because you're hard. There's hardness there. What is it that we have to do to be broken? Is to acknowledge our brokenness. And say, God, I'm broken, Lord. I need help. I need you to intervene in my life. I need you to do things in me that I can't get from no man, from no woman, that I can't get from anything outwardly. It all has to be done inwardly. And only your hands are the only hands that can get inside me. Yes. Your hands, God, are the only hands that can work inside me. You got to acknowledge that you're broken, and you need to get your brokenness and put it in the hands of God. Stop trying to hold on to it. Stop trying to repair yourself. Come on. Stop trying to look to man or to look to a woman to help get you right, to make you feel good. Come on. They don't have that power. They can't do that. Only God could fix, because He's the one that created us. God is the one that created us. Yes. Whenever you buy something and it goes wrong or there's a defect in it, you know, you could go ahead, or, you know, like you buy a car and you could go ahead and look for a backyard mechanic, but they're going to make things worse. Can I hear an amen, somebody? Unless, I don't want to offend any backyard mechanics here this morning, but I know you're here. Give it up. You don't know what you're doing. You just want to get paid. You just want to pay your bills. You just want some peace. You just want your wife to keep quiet for a little bit. Hello, I've been there. But if you really want to repair the vehicle, if you really want to repair something you have, what do you send it? Back to the maker. Whoever made it has a greater understanding on that vehicle than anybody else. I mean, the backyard mechanic could patch it up, make it run for another 30, 40 miles, but it's going to break again. Send it to the maker.
Amen.
When we find ourselves in brokenness, don't put it in the hands of Dr. Phil. Don't put it in the hands of some therapist. Don't put it in the hands of some medication. Don't put it in the hands of your husband or your wife. Get your brokenness and put it into the hands of the maker.
Amen.
The one that created you, that knows you better than anybody in this world. He's the one that created you. He knows why you think like that. He knows why you act like that. He knows why you're responding like that. He knows why you react like that. He knows why you're still angry. He knows why you're still holding on to unforgiveness. He knows why everything that's going on in your life. He knows.
Right.
He knows why. And if you really want to resolve things and you really want those things to begin to work for the good in your life, put it back in His hands. Put it in the hands of God. I'm going to have my wife come on up. I'm going to bring this to a close this morning. I like what John says in John chapter 12, verse 24. Verily, truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The seed that is used in this illustration, or the kernel of wheat that falls, is us. Is us. We are the ones that need to fall to the ground, and we need to die to ourselves. We need to die to our selfishness. We need to die to all these things, because when you're broken and you're still selfish, you're dangerous. When you're broken and you're still full of pride in your heart, you're very dangerous. You're very dangerous to yourself, first of all, and you're very dangerous to those that are around you that love you. Because it seems like when you're in that place, you hurt the ones you love. And when you're broken, and your brokenness is in the wrong hands, and you're still holding on to unforgiveness, you're dangerous. Very dangerous. God can't work in you until you fall to the ground and you die to yourself. Then through that process, God is able to multiply His blessing for your life. I like what Isaiah, as we all stand to our feet, Isaiah 57, 15. For this is what the high and exalted one says. He who lives forever, whose name is holy. I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit. To revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. That God says that though He's in heaven and He lives in a holy place, but those that are low in spirit, those that are have a brokenness and a contrite heart, those are the ones that He comes down to revive. To revive means to give life. To give life. Because when you're broken, you feel like your life is over. You feel like you have no life. You feel like your life is slipping right through your hands and you have no control over it. But my Bible says that God is close to the brokenhearted, and that He comes to come to revive us and to lift us up, to give us the strength for another day to do what we got to do. And as every head is bowed and every eye closed in the presence of God this morning, we can just all close our eyes this morning. And maybe you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ. And maybe you're at that place of brokenness right now. That's why you came this morning. Because you tried everything, but yet you have nothing. No change. There's no help, no hope. And you're here, you're saying, God, You see my heart. And you know what I need. And if you're here this morning and that's you, that's the cry of your heart, the first thing you need to do, if you haven't given your heart to Jesus, you need to surrender. You need to give your heart to Jesus this morning. You need to accept Him as your personal Lord and Savior. That's where everything begins. That's where the brokenness is transferred out of your hand, out of the devil's hands, and into the hands of God. And that's where God is able to work. If you're here this morning and say, that's me, Pastor, I want to give my heart to Jesus. And you want us to say a simple prayer. Maybe you backslidden, maybe you've fallen away. And you want to put your brokenness back in the hands of God. And your life back in the hands of God. And you want to rededicate your life. This is for you. And if you're here this morning, whether you want to accept Jesus for the first time and rededicate your life, I want you to raise your hand. If there's anybody in here this morning, you say, that's me, that's me, that's me. That's me. Just raise your hand. Maybe you're here this morning and maybe that's you. You're in a place of brokenness. And you know within your heart what's in there. And as the worship team makes their way up this morning, and if you're here and that's you, I want you to raise your hand. I want to pray with you. I see all those hands in the back. Just raise up your hand and you say, that's me, man. And maybe you're viewing brokenness as something bad, but it's good. As long as you're in the Lord. As long as you're in the Lord. I want you to raise your hand high. Don't be ashamed. My hand's up. I love to be broken in the presence of God. I'm not full of myself. I want to be full of God. And I know that it's only through my brokenness that I'm able to get to that place. Because we're deceived. We deceive ourselves. We get full of ourselves. And we don't even know it. And we think it's God, and it's not. It's okay to be broken. It's okay to be at that place of need. It's okay to feel, man, God, man, I know you're doing a great work in me, but man, I still feel, God, man, I need something in me. I need you, God. You complete me, but there's a yearning in me that there's more. There's more, God. There's more, and I want more. I want more. And I know that it comes when I'm broken in your presence and I'm laying on my face before you, God. It's in brokenness where God builds you. It's in brokenness where God ignites a fire in you. Those that are carrying that torch are, believe me, they're broken, but you might not see their brokenness because it's not demonstrated in front of man. It's demonstrated in front of God. Because in their time and prayer, they're broken in the presence of God. And they know that they rely and depend on Him and Him alone. And if you're here this morning and that's you, I want to pray. I want you to come to the altar as they get ready to sing a song this morning. Just come to the altar. You know who you are.
For more information about our church, visit our website at lwchfoursquare.com. Also like our Facebook page at Living Word of Chino Hills. And follow us on Instagram at lwch. We hope that you enjoyed this video. Thank you and God bless.